In my Structural Engineering Made Simple series, today I would like to talk about design of doubly reinforced rectangular sections for bending. Please take a moment and read the disclaimer at the bottom of this slide before we continue. Doubly reinforced rectangular sections are designed for longitudinal steel bars for bending and transverse reinforcement for shear. The longitudinal bars are designated as tension and compression steel. This video explains the design for bending and the computation of the area of tension and compression steel. For design of singly reinforced sections, please see video 7, and for shear, see video 8 in my series on Structural Engineering Made Simple. In general, the process includes the design for the size of the cross section, the amount of steel needed for tension and compression reinforcement, number of bars and the bar arrangement, and the detailing of the section. These are the pertinent references used in the preparation of this video. Why do we design a rectangular section as a doubly reinforced one? Generally, we design a beam with a doubly reinforced section when 1. The singly reinforced section is not able to efficiently provide the needed nominal bending resistance and the beam size cannot be changed because of, for example, architectural limitations. In older design methods where maximum steel ratio was used to limit tension steel, this situation could easily be explained when the required steel ratio exceeded the maximum. This was an indication that the singly reinforced section was not an option, and if the section could not be enlarged, then we needed to design the section as a doubly reinforced to gain additional bending resistance needed. 2. The section is intentionally designed as doubly reinforced for a more controlled long-term deflection due to the concrete creep. Compression steel is effective in reducing the long-term deflection. 3. The section undergoes positive and negative moments alternatively, for example, in seismic load environments. In these situations, we make sure the section is properly designed as a doubly reinforced one. These figures show typical doubly reinforced cross sections and their bar arrangements. This one shows a doubly reinforced rectangular section with one layer of tension steel. And the one to the right shows a doubly reinforced rectangular section with multiple layers of tension steel. Here are the notations. AS is the area of tension steel. A prime sub S is the area of compression steel. B and H are the section width and height. D is the distance of center of tension steel from compression face of the beam. D sub T is a distance showing the location of the first layer of tension steel, farthest layer from the extreme concrete compression fiber. DT is equal to D when only one layer of tension steel is used. D prime is a distance of center of compression steel from compression face of the beam. F prime sub C and Fi are respectively the concrete compressive strength and the steel yield strength either in PSI or KSI. M sub U is a factored applied moment and M sub N is a nominal flexural resistance of the cross section. Epsilon T is a strain in the first layer of steel, farthest layer from compressive concrete fiber. Phi is the resistance reduction factor. Rho is a tension steel ratio, which is AS divided by BD. And rho prime is a compression steel ratio, which is A prime sub S divided by BD. Nominal resistance MN. It is important to know the equation for the nominal resistance MN before we can proceed in establishing a procedure for design. The following figures show the strain diagram and the stress distribution across the cross section of a doubly reinforced rectangular section. As you can see in the middle figure in the longitudinal detail, there are three forces shown. C prime sub S is a compression force on the compression steel, C prime sub C is a compression force on concrete, and T is a tension force in the tension steel. Also notice to the right, the strain diagram is shown with a value at the extreme compressive fiber in concrete, which is at the compression face of the beam at 0.003. Notice that if one layer of tension steel is used, D is equal to DT. The following equations describe the forces. C prime sub C is 0.85 F prime sub C BA. C prime S is A prime sub S F prime sub S, and T is equal to AS FY. Also, F prime sub S is equal to epsilon prime S times ES. F prime sub S is the compressive stress on the compression steel. It is equal to 87,000 psi times X minus D prime divided by X. However, the value cannot exceed Fy. From ACI, A is equal to beta 1 x, where beta 1 is equal to 0.85 for a prime sub c of 4000 psi or smaller, and for every 1000 psi above 4000 psi, beta 1 is reduced by 0.05. However, the smallest possible value for beta 1 is 0.65. To better understand the derivation of the equation for Mn, the cross section is assumed to be made up of two separate sections. Here is the cross section detail. It is assumed that it is made up of cross section C and cross section S. Section C balances the compression force C prime sub C of concrete with a tension force in a portion of tension steel that we call it ASC. Section S balances the compression force C prime sub S of compression steel with the tension force in the remainder of the tension steel. We call that remainder as ASS. As you can see, cross section C is made up of ASC and concrete. However, cross-section S is made up of ASS and A prime sub S only, with no concrete. And AS is equal to ASC plus ASS. Using the equilibrium of internal forces in section S, ASSFY is equal to A prime sub S times F prime sub S minus 0.85 F prime sub C. The term 0.85 F prime sub C is deducted from F prime sub S to account for the displaced area of concrete when the compression bars are placed. This term can be neglected for simplicity. From this equation, we can solve for ASS, which is A prime sub S times F prime sub S minus 0.85 F prime sub C divided by Fy. And MNS is equal to ASSFY D minus D prime. MNS is a nominal bending resistance provided by section S. And this equation is the moment equilibrium equation. Using the equilibrium of internal forces in section C, A is equal to ASCFY divided by 0.85 F prime sub CB. Notice that ASC is equal to AS minus ASS, and MNC is equal to ASCFY D minus A over 2, where MNC is a nominal moment resistance provided by section C. Therefore, the total resistance of the cross section MN is the summation of MNC and NMS, which is equal to ASCFY D minus A over 2, plus ASSFY D minus D prime. For the factor resistance phi MN, the resistance reduction factor phi is needed, where The smallest possible value for phi is 0.65 when epsilon t is smaller or equal to 0.002. The largest value for phi is 0.9 when epsilon t is larger or equal to 0.005. For the values in between the two limits, phi is obtained from the middle equation. And from this strain diagram, epsilon t is shown to be equal to 0.003 times dt minus x divided by x. Determination of a prime sub s. We need to compute a prime sub s in order to determine mn. We can use one of the following two methods. The exact solution. This can be achieved by using the following equations to form a quadratic equation for a prime sub s. These are the equations. The first equation shows a prime sub s in terms of x. Second equation shows that x is a function of a, and a is a function of a sub sc. And a sub sc in turn is a function of ass, because ASC is equal to AS minus ASS. And finally, we'll see in the last equation that ASS is a function of a prime sub S. The good news is that there are plenty of equations that we can use to eliminate all the unknowns that we don't need and write one equation in terms of a prime sub S. And the equation in terms of a prime sub S is a quadratic equation as shown in here. As you can see, the parameters of these quadratic equations are all now known. They are a in terms of AS, FI, F prime sub C, A prime sub S, D prime and B and beta 1. In this equation, kips and inch units are used. Furthermore, note that F prime sub S cannot exceed FI. The approximate solution is done by trial and error. In this method, we start by assuming an initial value for a prime sub s. Usually, we start by taking a prime sub s equal to fy. Using this assumed value, we find ass, then asc. By knowing asc, we compute a, x, and then again f prime sub s. We now start a new iteration by using this value of prime sub s and repeat the process until there is an accepted small difference between the newest value of a prime sub s and the previous one. Let's look at an example. In a rectangular 20 by 30 inch section, a prime sub s is made up of two number 8s, so the area is 1.58 square inches. And AS is made up of four number 10, so the area is 5.08 square inches. B is equal to 20 inches, and using number 3 stirrups and 1.5 inches of protection cover for bars, we have D prime equal to 2.38 and D is equal to 27.49. Using F prime sub C as 4 KSI and FY as 60 KSI, we use the exact method by plugging the above values in our equation and we form the quadratic equation shown. F prime sub S is squared minus 283.3 F prime sub S plus 9504.4 equal to 0. And in this equation, F prime sub S is in KSI. There are two answers to the equation. Usually one answer is much larger than FI, which is discarded. So the accepted answer is F prime sub S equal to 38.9 KSI. Let's use the approximate method for the same problem. We start with an initial value of prime sub s equal to 60 KSI. We compute ASS, which is A prime sub s times F prime sub s minus 0.85 F prime sub c divided FY. The value is 1.49 square inches. We deduct that from the AS, we get ASC, which is 3.59. From there, we find the parameter A, which is 3.17. And from A, we find X, which is 3.73. Now, by knowing X, we can compute F prime sub S again which is 87 ksi x minus t prime over x, the answer is 31.5 ksi. Notice we started from 60, we ended up with 31.5 ksi. Quite a large difference between them. Let's start a second trial. Now here, if we use 31.5 ksi for a prime sub s, repeating the computations, we end up with 41 ksi. And as you can see, the gap is now reduced. We do two more iterations using a prime sub s equal to 41. Repeating the same computations, we ended up with a new value for a prime sub s as 38.2 ksi. And if you use 38.2 ksi, we ended up with 39.1 ksi. And we can pretty much stop the iteration there. We have an accurate or reasonably an accurate value for a prime sub s now. Maximum steel ratio. The idea of limiting a steel ratio to a maximum value is no longer emphasized in ACI. However, in this video, we discuss the idea of using maximum steel ratio in design because it provides a convenient way of deciding whether we need to design as a doubly reinforced section or not. The limiting value for the steel is introduced through a new parameter rho bar max, where rho bar max is equal to rho max plus rho prime f prime sp divided by fy. F prime sp is the stress at the compression steel at the balance condition. It can be shown that it is equal to ES, which is the modulus of elasticity of steel, times epsilon u minus d prime over d times epsilon u plus epsilon y. However, the quantity cannot exceed fy. Rho max, this one without a bar, is a maximum steel ratio for a singly reinforced section. It is 0.85 prime sub c, beta 1 divided by fy, multiply by epsilon u divided by epsilon u plus 0.004. Plugging epsilon u equal to 0.003, we find out that rho max is 0.85 prime sub c beta 1 divided by fy multiplied by 3 over 7. Please notice that again, this is the maximum steel ratio in a singly reinforced section. And epsilon y is ES divided by Fy. Here is an important observation. If we assume f prime sub sp is equal to Fy, then rho bar max would be equal to rho max plus rho prime. This is to say that the maximum steel ratio in a doubly reinforced section is actually equal to maximum steel ratio in a singly reinforced section plus an extension term which is called rho prime. And if the actual steel ratio is rho, knowing that rho is smaller than or equal to rho bar max, we can write that rho minus rho prime is smaller or equal to rho max. This means that any time we add compression steel, approximately an equal amount of tension steel will need to be added to the existing tension steel so that the difference between rho and rho prime will never exceed the maximum steel ratio rho max. Minimum amount of reinforcement. Usually, this is not related to doubly reinforced section. It is not governing the design. And is usually this one is more pertinent to the singly reinforced section. Nevertheless, it's a good idea to check the amount of steel against the minimum value to make sure that we have at least the minimum amount. The ACI recommended minimum value is 3 square root of prime sub c over fy times bd and 200 over fy bd, whichever is larger. In practice, however, alternatively, AS minimum is taken as 4/3 of the required AS. Other design considerations. ACI recommends H at least equal to L over 16 for simply supported beams where L is equal to the span length. For a good proportion, we can use B about 1/2 to 2/3 of H. As a preliminary value, D can be taken as H minus about 2.5 to 3.5 inches for most ordinary cases, and D prime can be taken about 2.5 inches. Of course, when other parameters are determined, an exact value for each of these two parameters can be found. K Clear spacing between bars selected cannot be less than 1 inch or diameter of the bar, whichever is larger in horizontal direction, and 1 inch in the vertical direction between layers. The cross-section height H is mostly taken as an even number. The number of bars selected must be symmetric with respect to the vertical axis passing through the cross-section center. As a start, the stirrups can be taken as number 3 bars with 3/8 of an inch in diameter. The maximum bar size that can be used for a beam is number 11 with 1.41 inches of diameter. This table provides bar sizes, diameters, and cross-sectional areas of bar sizes from number 3 to number 11. Design steps. Step 1. Select the starting size for the beam. Take H at least equal to L over 16 and B about 1/2 to 2/3 of H. Step 2. Knowing B and H, compute the self-weight of the beam as a uniformly distributed load and add it to the dead load and modify MU. The beam self-weight is B times H times gamma, the unit of pounds per foot, where gamma is the concrete density, equal to 150 pounds per cubic foot. Step 3, assume phi is equal to 0.9 and we will check it later. Step 4, assume D about H minus 2.5 to 3.5 inches and D prime about 2.5 inches. These are the starting values. Step 5, take the required MN equal to MU divided by phi. MN is the capacity that the section will need to provide. Step 6, compute ASC as rho max times BD. This is the maximum amount of steel that can be used for a singly reinforced section. And as you recall, rho max is 0.85 prime sub c beta 1 divided by Fi multiplied by 3 over 7. By knowing this maximum amount of steel, we can compute the corresponding A, and from there, in step 8, we compute the MNC max, which is ASCFI D minus A over 2. This MNC max could be used as a parameter to determine whether compression steel is needed or not. So in step 9, if required, MN is smaller than MNC max, no compression steel is needed. We can design as a singly reinforced section following lesson 7 in this series. In step 10, if the required MN is larger than MNC max, that's an indication compression is still needed. And the additional strength MNS is the required MN minus MNC max. We go to step 11. By knowing MNS, we can compute the ASS, the required amount of steel in the tension area, the additional steel. However, before we do that, in step 11, we compute X and then a prime sub S. A prime sub S is 87,000 psi times X minus D prime divided by X. And now in step 12, we compute ASS, which is MNS divided by Fi times D minus D prime. Step 13. Now we compute the steel areas needed as follows, and then we select appropriate bars. AS is a summation of ASC plus ASS, and A prime sub S is the ASS that we computed in step 12, multiplied by Fi, divided by F prime sub S minus 0.5 F prime sub C. Step 14, knowing the bar arrangement, we compute the actual values for D and D prime. We assume number 3 stirrups and use 1.5 inches of protection cover and 1 inch clear spacing between layers if more than one layer of steel is used for the tension steel. Here is a simple case of one layer of tension steel, and D is simply obtained as H minus 1.5 inches plus DS plus 1/2 of diameter of the bar DB. In this case, multiple layers of tension steel are used, and especially in this case, two layers are used, layer 1 and layer 2. Computation of D is more involved. D is equal to H minus E, where E is equal to E1 AS1 plus E2 AS2 divided by AS. And the detail to the right shows what the E1 and E2 distances are. We can compute those by knowing the bar sizes. For layer 1, E1 is 1.5 inches plus DS plus 0.5 dB. For layer 2, E2 is 1.5 inches plus DS plus 1.5 times dB plus 1 inch. And that 1 inch is the clear spacing in the vertical direction. D prime calculation is simple. That's 1.5 plus DS plus 0.5 D prime B. And again, DB is a tension bar diameter, DS is a stirrup diameter, and D prime B is a compression bar diameter. Step 15, knowing the bar size and number of bars, we compute the actual AS and A prime sub S, and then a prime sub S, ASS, A, and MN. The sequence of equations is given below. First, the quadratic equation for a prime sub S, then the ASS equation, ASC equation, A equation, and finally the MN equation, which is a total bending resistance of the cross section. Step 16, knowing X, which is equal to A over beta 1, we compute epsilon T as 0.003 times dt minus x over x, and find out the phi and make sure the phi mn is larger than mu. When phi mn is larger than mu, we know that our design is satisfactory. What if situations? What if rho is less than rho minimum? As we said before, this is usually not pertinent to doubly reinforced section. However, if you have to provide the minimum amount of steel, we can use 4/3 of the required AS. What if rho is larger than rho bar max? This usually happens more often. In this situation, we increase a prime sub S, which means increasing rho prime. And to increase a rho prime or a prime sub S, the best solution would be to add one or two sides to the bars that we are using in the compression area. The increase in rho prime will increase rho bar max, and that would fix the problem. If this still does not improve the situation, consider using a larger cross section. What if at the end of the design, we still find out that we need additional strength, yet we cannot increase the cross section size? In this situation, we compute the extra strength that needed as follows. We call the extra strength needed as delta MNS, which is the required MN minus the available MN. The extra steels needed are designated as delta ASS and delta A prime S, which can be computed from step 10 using delta MNS in place of the MNS in the equation. Then we revise the total steel and repeat steps 13 through 16. If we have to still fix the problem further, we repeat these steps if necessary to obtain the resistance that is needed. Other detailing considerations. Please consult with the ACI code regarding these issues. Number one, the bars are generally cut when they are no longer needed and MU is reduced. However, bars will need to continue by a distance LD before they are actually cut, where LD is the development length. Equations for LD are given in the ACI code for various conditions. Two, for crack control purposes, spacing the first layer of bars cannot exceed the smaller of the following values: 15 inches times 40,000 over FS minus 2.5 times parameter C sub C, and 12 inches times 40,000 divided by FS. We are using inches and pounds in these equations. The parameter C sub C is the least distance from surface of bar to tension face, and FS is a surface stress on a steel and can be taken as 2/3 of Fy. 3. Longitudinal skin reinforcement is needed if S is larger than 36 inches. You know, for H values over 36 inches, we need to provide this skin reinforcement and uniformly distribute this reinforcement on both side faces of the beam for a distance h over 2 from the tension face. Maximum spacing of skin reinforcement follows the above limits, where C sub C in this case is a clear cover from the skin reinforcement to the side face. Number 5 bars can be used for this purpose. 4. Bar sizes can be mixed, but the maximum size difference is 2. For example, number 7 bars can be mixed with number 5, number 6, number 8, and number 9 only. Let's look at an example. In this example, we would like to design reinforcing bars for a simply supported beam of a rectangular 14 by 18 inch cross section and a total factor bending moment of mu equal to 305 foot cubes. This value includes the self weight of the beam. The beam size cannot be changed. We use a prime sub C of 4000 and a phi of 60,000 psi. We also use number 3 bars for stirrups. Assume phi is equal to 0.9 and we'll check it later. The required nominal resistance Mn is 305 divided by 0.9, which is 338.9 foot cubes. And the value for rho max is 0.0206. Let's assume D is equal to 15.5 and D prime is 2.5 inches as the starting values. That would give us ASC as 0.0206 times 14, which is B, and 15.5, which is D. The answer is 4.47 square inches. Remember, this is the maximum amount of steel we can use if we wanted to design as a singly reinforced section. The corresponding A value for that ASC is computed. By plugging the numbers in the equation, we get 5.63 inches, and the x is equal to 5.63 divided by 0.85, which is 6.62 inches. We're going to be using this x later. But for now, let's compute the maximum resisting moment, MNC max, which is ASCFI D minus A over 2. This maximum corresponds with a singly reinforced section. The answer is 283.5 foot cubes. Now, if the required Mn is 338.9, certainly we are short of resisting moment. Therefore, compression steel is needed to provide the additional resistance that is required. The additional resistance is a difference of 338.9 and 283.5, which is 55.4 foot cubes. We take this one as MnS, and based on that, x that we computed before, let's compute a prime sub s first. A prime sub s is 87 ksi times x minus d prime over x. The answer is 54.1 ksi. And then we can find ass, which is mns divided by fy d minus d prime. The answer is 0.85 square inches. And by knowing a prime sub s, now we can find a prime sub s, which is equal to 1.01 square inches. Notice that A prime sub S is fairly close to ASS. Usually that is the case. In fact, if a prime sub S is equal to FY, A prime sub S is approximately the same as ASS. Finally, our AS is ASC plus ASS, so the total amount of tension still needed is 5.32 square inches. Knowing the two values, we can try bars. And we're going to try 3 number 8 as compression steel and 2 number 11 plus 2 number 10 as tension steel. You probably noticed that we are using a little bit more than what we need for both compression and tension steel. We have done a couple of trials and this is the trial number 3. We ended up with this amount of steel. And that is not unusual. Sometimes we have to do more than one or two trials to come up with an appropriate bar size for our design. Now, of course, A prime sub S and AS are different from what the design recommended. And remember, our D and D prime were just approximate values anyway. So let's compute them now. D is equal to 15.42 and D prime is 2.38 inches. From the quadratic equation that we gave before, we can accurately compute the prime sub s. Plugging numbers there, we form the quadratic equation, and the acceptable answer is 50.3 ksi. As you can see, this one is lower than the previous value. However, As an approximation, the previous value could be used with some approximation, and the final result, of course, will not be 100% accurate. But this value of prime sub s is very accurate. Let's find out ASS, which is a prime sub s times f prime sub s minus 0.85 prime sub c over fi. The answer is 1.85 square inches. And deduct this value from AS, we get ASC, which is 3.81. That would give us the value for A, and from there the value for X. A is equal to 4.8 and X is equal to 5.65 inches. Plugging all of those in the equation for MN, we get the total capacity as 368.7 foot cubes. Before we can check whether our section is okay or not, let's compute phi. For that, we need epsilon t, which is 0.003 dt minus x over x. Dt is the same as d, is 15.42, and x is 5.65. The answer for epsilon is 0.0052, which is exceeding 0.005. Therefore, phi is equal to 0.9, as we assume. The factored resistance phi mn is therefore 0.9 times 368.7, which is 331.8 foot cubes. Certainly, this is larger than mu of 305, so our design is okay. And here is our detail for the cross section we just designed. Because it is a simply supported beam, the compression is at the top, so the three number 8 bars go to the top. 2 number 11 plus 2 number 10 tension still go to the bottom. Let's check rho minimum and rho maximum. Rho minimum is 0.0033 and rho bar max is rho max plus rho prime f prime sp over fi. Remember, f prime sp has its own equation. Rho max is 0.0206. Epsilon u is 0.003. Epsilon y is fy divided by the modulus of elasticity es. So plugging the numbers there, we can compute the prime sp. But before that, let's compute rho prime, which is 2.37 divided by 14 and 15.42. The answer is 0.011. And rho is equal to 5.66 divided by 14, which is B, and D, which is 15.42, is 0.0262. Now, plugging numbers in the equation for F prime SP, we have the value, numerical value 64.4, but of course it cannot exceed 60, therefore F prime SP is equal to 60 KSI. So now we can compute our rho bar max, which is 0.0316. As you can see, our rho is between the rho max and rho mean, therefore our design is okay. The bar arrangement design is for the maximum bending moment that happens at the midspan. Away from the midspan, 2 number 10 can be cut and the other 2 11 can continue. However, the location of the cutoff point must comply with the resistance of the section for the 2 number 11 bars. Furthermore, the bars must continue for at least a distance equal to the development length before they are cut. If you are interested in to know how to design a singly reinforced section for bending and how to design for shear, please see lessons 7 and 8 in this series. Thank you for watching this video.